A já než předám slovo, možná ti, kteří z vás sem chodí na naše setkání pravidelně, si vzpomenou na minulé přednášky.
Maybe some of you who are regular visiting these conferences, so many of you may remember Mr. Rosenberg, who was talking about the detecting the presence movement and so on. So I think that in this case, I think this is a very thing after the events in Korea. And now I pass over to Mr. Rosenberg.
And
thank you very much for making the presentation.
Thank you very much. I'm going to talk about crowd analytics and specifically about how crowd analytics can solve real problems. Basically, crowd analytics is the method to understand what crowd is doing, what our people are doing. People sitting here in this room, how many people we have, how much time they spend, if some of them are going out or going in, all this kind of information is crowd analytics. We want to understand what the crowd is doing, and then we want to give something useful out of this kind of understanding. What are the methods to monitor crowd activity? Basically, there are four types of sensors or data that can be collected to understand crowd. The first one, and actually the most common one, is video analytics, camera, CCTV. Many of those cameras are able to count, to measure, and to know if there are people there. The more smarter they are, they can do more. When they are able to, in a place, for example, in a place like this room, if we will cover it correctly with video cameras, it will be possible to understand how many people are here and the movement pattern, for example. The second source for crowd analytics, which is more useful for larger area, are mobile application. Starting from what Google and Apple are collecting from your phones, which is your location, basically, and different kind of applications that are doing more or less the same. So people using mobile application, if they are using location data, their location is exposed, and sometimes this information is used for good, sometimes this information is used for other purposes, but this is a way to know what's going on in a large areas. The third kind of information is basically telco operator. Your cellular operator has a similar information. He knows where you are, more or less, and he knows what is your activity pattern, and he knows from your bill, he may know your age, gender, and how much you are using your phone, and so on. So cellular operators are more or less a good data source for crowd, large-scale crowd analytics. The last one is IoT sensors, like the ones that we are generating. Basically, they are using the same data. We are using data collected from mobile phones, transmitted, it's called probing messages, but it's a data collected generated by mobile phone to understand the location of the phone. This is true for Android, this is true for iOS, and we are putting sensors that are software radio and listening to those data, which is encrypted, and we can get the same information, like how many people are here, what they are, how long they stay, and so on. So those are, in general, the four methods to collect data for crowd analytics. So technology is nice, but in reality, customers are not interested in technology. They want solutions. They have a problem, they want to find a solution. And what I'm going to do is to show some problems, different kind of problems, and explain the solution that we provide to those kind of customers. I will focus on few market segments, which are basically advertisement, especially out-of-home advertisement. It's security and political. So what are the kind of things that people are asking or cities are asking? So where are the people in the city? Where are the tourists going? how they are moving, how they are moving from place to place. What is their kind of behavior? There is a lot of reasons to collect this kind of information. If you want to improve your public transportation service, you need information what people want to do with this public transportation service. If you want to deploy an advertisement, you want to deploy it in a place where people will see it. If you are in a city and you like tourists to come to your city, you want to make sure that your advertisement campaign is useful and it was effective, and you want to check that tourists are really coming. And if something is changed, you want to know about it. There are cities that actually want exactly the opposite. They don't want tourists to come. So they still need to monitor to make sure that less tourists are coming and it's becoming more convenient for the citizens. I will go to case study, because I think, in my opinion, this is the thing that really explain how this kind of technology can be used. In Asia, it is very common that elections are done using tracks or some kind of a mobile platforms. So there is a track, on this track there is a used a TV screen, there are even people standing on the track and giving some speech. And those tracks, whenever there is an election, are running around the cities and around the countries and giving the message of the specific candidate, actually, all the candidates. This is very common. I think it's originally coming from Japan. It's very common in Korea. It's very common in Thailand, and not very common elsewhere, as much as I know. So the question that is coming here, how many people are exposed to this advertisement? So the party, the one that organized this one, is spending a lot of money to prepare those cars, to rent them, and to prepare all the stuff. So how many people are exposed? And this is exactly what crowd analytics is provided. In our case, we put a small sensor inside those trucks, and the sensor gives the information of how many people were able to listen to the message that this specific truck is given. And then on a day-by-day message, if the numbers were too low, they simply send it to a different location. So if you send to a specific area of the city and nobody is listening, let's send the same truck to another place tomorrow so more people will be able to listen to this. Another problem, and this is very common, I think, also here. There are many cars, vehicles that have advertisement on it. Normally it's taxi, but it's not necessarily taxi. It can be also some delivery trucks and some other. So people are spending their money, they're putting in advertisement on those cars, and they would like people to see it. The problem is that it's very difficult to measure how many people are exposed to those kind of trucks. And again, the solution is actually more or less the same. We put a sensor inside the truck, inside the vehicle, and the sensor can measure the mobile phones that are within a range, a specific range from this vehicle, and then it can tell, okay, this taxi today, and this location, 10,000 people had been able or exposed to this one. So based on this information, we can give the value of those advertisements. And since they are quite pricey, the advertiser would like to know that there was a good reason to spend their money on those kind of advertisement. Taxis are the most common, and they are the ones that are coming quite a lot with those kind of requirement, but a similar example can be a delivery truck where we can put your advertisement on it, or even some service truck or service car of a company that want to do. I'm aware of multiple initiatives to give private car owner some payment based on and if they will agree to put advertisement from Switzerland to India, but based off my knowledge, none of them is very commercially successful. A similar area, and actually a very similar case, is exhibition and art. Actually, art is very good market segment for us. In this specific case, which is taken from Singapore, National Gallery Singapore, is doing a moving exhibition. They have an exhibition inside the vehicle, and every day they move to another place. Normally schools. And they want to know, okay, are people are looking at it or not? How many people are able to look at it? How many people are exposed? This is anyhow something that is coming for free. So the main goal of this one is to expose people to art and to expose this. So this is a way to measure that the event is successful and people are actually able to look at it. Another case, And this is more and more, and I think we are already doing one example here in Prague, and more are coming. And the problem is like this: there are many bus stops, and most of the cases and most of the cities have quite a lot of information about what's going on within the public transportation, not everywhere. But many countries collect whenever you go in and whenever you go out, so they have a lot of information what's going inside the public transportation. But nobody knows what is going on the people that are waiting. So how long people are waiting normally for the bus? This is something nobody knows. Is it crowded? How many people are waiting here? Where they plan to go? And the solution for this is to put sensors inside the bus stop themselves and find out what's going on before people going on to the bus or to the tram or to the train or to the station. Specifically, there is a lot of many initiatives for smart bus stops coming with different approaches, from making it more warm in winter, cold in summer, pollution, less polluted, so people will not have to stay in a polluted street but stay inside in a purified area, and a lot of initiatives around. And all those initiatives need to know if people are using it or not using it. In this case, what we are doing is putting a small IoT sensor inside the bus stop and provide this kind of information. Another example related to mobility. This is coming from Seoul, an area of the city which is called Sinchon, and this area wants to promote the use of e-bikes. So the next question for e-bike is, okay, where should we put them? Because they need some kind of charging stations, they need to be located, so we don't want to locate them in a place where people will use them. And then once you make this decision, it's very difficult to move because the investment in charging and allocating the space is quite huge. So what this city has done is put tons of sensors. You can see the sensors on the map. You can see that there are many, actually every place on this area is covered with sensors in order to understand what are the mobility patterns of the people, where they are going, where they are coming, where they want to go. And based on this, they make a decision how to put or where to put the e-bike charging station so people will use it and find the way how to make people more convenient there. This is an example actually taken here from IMA offices. And one of the questions that we are facing and coming in many places is how many people are sitting inside the car? And there are a few examples. So there are, of course, when you plan, when you are a transportation planner, you want as many people as possible that will be in the car because you waste the energy, the car doing the same effort. It doesn't matter if there is only one person or five people, more or less it's the same energy consumption and everything is similar. So we want to know if this place or how many people are actually inside the car. It's very easy to count cars. CCTV systems are doing it very well, but it's very difficult to count how many people are inside because you have to look through the windows and the windows are actually not easy to look, especially with inside the car and so on. So what we have done is we put a special sensor with some kind of a special antenna, and the sensor is monitoring the street, or in other cases, is monitoring bridges. And this one is counting actually the number of people inside the cars, and we make multiple tests to compare this data compared to CCTV that counts the number of cars and to find out how many people are inside. In this specific example, most of the car, only a single passenger, I have to say. We have done a similar experiment in a place called Name in Korea, where there are two bridges, it's an island. Two bridges are leading to this island. One is used by tourists, and the number of passengers per car is 2.3 average. And the second one is used by local, and the number is 1.3, mainly delivery and other kinds. So you can see that this kind of information provide a very useful information, in this case, for the city, for the planning. So if all the tourists are coming on one bridge, this is a place where they should take them and make sure that they will go wherever the city wants them to go. This is a safety use case. So I think everyone is familiar with those radars that tell you are driving too fast. And this is very common. They are very common everywhere. I have seen also here some of those. In this specific place, this is some kind of a rural area. There are a road that you can see here. It looks empty, but is actually people are driving quite fast there. And in many places behind the corner of this road, there are people. Sometimes it's school, sometimes it's elderly house, sometimes it's a small village. And specifically at night, when someone is driving fast, he has no clue that there are people around the corner. So we will give him a clue here. And this kind of system is a radar combined with a note how many people are hidden behind this corner of the, this corner of the street. So people are telling them, so this system is telling them, okay, you are driving too fast or you are driving too early, but be also careful because there are people behind. And this is the number of people waiting for you behind this corner. This is a pilot in, I think, 5 or 6 locations, small villages around Korea. And I think the potential in making more safety road is quite high for this kind of systems. This is another safety application for those kind of IoT sensor, and this is a protection of national park. This is a bridge, which is a tourist attraction, and some of the people here had been on this bridge. And the problem in this place is how to make sure that during closing hours, nobody will be there. This is actually a quite common problem in national parks because the parks at night normally belong to the animals and people should not be there. What we can find and what we can see is that in many cases there are still people around. First, some of them getting lost. Second, some of them, I don't know, don't like to walk at night and some other things. So in this case specifically, the customers put a system here to make sure that nobody will be there at night. Of course, we found people at night and the customers, okay, so people go out and he had to send his security guard to tell them that it's not allowed and so on. But this is another example of a safety application. How come that crowd analytics can use for safety? One more thing is open data initiatives and how city can support the local businesses. So cities in many places would like to help the citizen. And part of the method to help the citizen is by providing data. You want to open a shop. You are a local citizen, you want to open a shop. So you have to decide where to put the shop or where to open your shop. So people are looking around, looking at the city data, and the city will provide you information. Okay, this is a crowded area, this is less crowded area. This is what you should expect in this one. In some cases, you can even get information like this is what you are going to earn. A typical coffee shop in this area will make, $10,000 a month. This is information the cities provide to customers, to citizens for free, normally. And we collect the data for this kind of information. And we collect the data actually for the city, or the city collects the data using our sensor and publish it. This example is a traditional market, and there is initiative in the Korean government to make traditional market more modern, let's say, and less traditional. So they spend a lot of money to renovate those markets, and they put sensors to make sure that people are really coming to those renovation part, and if they are not coming, to understand why they are not coming and what's the problem around the place. This is a similar example for underground shopping mall. In this place, which is located underground, it's like a combination of a small shopping mall underground. There are a few purposes of this one. So in this specific case, the customer is all city, and they want to do a few things. First of all, the owner of the shop, they want to provide them data like we described before. So if you want to open your shop here, they will give you the information how many people are around and to know what's happened. They also want to avoid too many people at the same place. So they want to know in case the staff become overcrowded. There was 2 weeks ago a terrible incident in a place called Itaewon, which, by the way, never invest even a penny on security and safety. But in this area, they want to know. If it's too crowded, they would let you know. Don't go there, it's too crowded. Take the left side, less crowded. And the last one, it was used during the COVID time. It was also used for measuring the maximal number. There was a restriction on the maximal number of people allowed to be on public places per square meter, and this information had been used to control this kind of data. So again, on this roof, there is every 10 meter more or less sensors that count how many people are per this specific area. So this conjunction level can be calculated. Another use case for crowd analytics is outdoor event and festival. So normally if there is a festival or a football or something that you sell ticket, you know how many people are inside because you count the ticket. But many events are completely free. So you just do something outside, I don't know, Christmas market. So nobody pay to enter to this market. So how many people are coming? Is it useful or is it not useful? Was it success or not? This is an example for a garden festival, gardening festival taking place in Singapore. Again, for free, you don't have to pay, but the question is, are people are enjoying it or not enjoying it? Because they spend quite a lot of money to prepare this festival. And this is where sensors that are able to measure the number of people around can come into position. So in those festivals, for example, in each place where the festival took place, there was a sensor in the middle, and the system tell how many people are coming per hour, per day, and so on. This is another example for a free festival. This is a theater which provide free shows. Every day, 3 times a day, you can see a show which is like a public service. And again, the question is how many people are coming? Is it a successful show or not successful show? And how people are behaved? Shows are around half an hour. What we found out that the number of people that come, watch 5 minutes and continue is huge, which is, if it's good or bad, I'm not sure. But this is the phenomena here. And this is what we measure. So we know later on to tell, okay, this show, which the customer spend this amount of money, generates this amount of attraction. How many people spend all the time? How many people just look and continue to move around? So this was like, I gave a very fast list of many applications where crowd analytics can be used. This is more or less a trigger for you. So if you have something useful that you think that crowd analytics can help on your specific case, you are of course welcome to come and talk. Then, few other things. Crowd analytics is coming end to end with privacy issues because we collect data that our sensor collect data that is actually private and contain private information. It's allowed to collect private information as long as there are some restrictions. For example, what is the purpose of collecting this kind of data? What are you doing with this data? Are we collecting it forever? Are we removing the data whenever it's not necessary, and so on and so on? So we are doing a lot of effort around this area, and we have a few patents and a few methods how to make the data more secure and more private. But this is like an open area, and there is always a room for improvement, and there is always a room to do better on privacy around this kind of data. This is how it looks like. This is a sensor. This is how it looks like inside. It's about the size. And there are different kind and different, with different models. This is our low-cost sensors. So it's very simple, and it's worked like a CCTV, just connected to PoE, and that's it, and it works. And this is our team. Our team located, our main R&D facility is in Korea. We are headquartered in Singapore, and we are now starting initiative to move our European headquarters towards the Czech Republic. Any questions? If not, I need to send everyone to the coffee.
Erel, thank you very much.